So let me talk about the tools that we're going to use when we use this gas-shielded MIG process that I'm going to show you. And all I'm going to show you is just this one process and just on steel. That's all I work with. And so, you know, my welder will do aluminum and stainless, but that's not really the kind of stuff that I'm interested in. I'm interested in making things for my shop and steel furniture and things like that. So I'm not really going to cover that. There's plenty of other places that cover that. Well, the very first thing that everyone needs to have before they do anything with welding is a really good, charged, powerful fire extinguisher. That's number one. Now, I have just this this little Miller 140 MIG welder, and I've had this for about 7 years, and I've just run this thing super hard. And it just does everything I want it to do. I can weld all kinds of stuff. I have friends that really want to get into welding, but they're also hard-headed at the same time. And so they don't want to buy a welder because they want to buy a welder that they can weld 5/8 inch plate in a single pass, even though, you know, I ask them, I say, what do you, you know, go work in a shipyard? Is that what you're going to do? You know, do you really need to be able to weld 5/8 of an inch in a single pass? I don't. You know, I could weld 5/8 of an inch, but I may have to do it in multiple passes, but I would do that very, very seldom. I'm mostly doing, you know, angle iron and pipe. I do a lot of welding with pipe. And so, you know, for me, this has been all the welder I need. I really like the accessible compact gun that it has. It's very comfortable and easy to use. So I haven't really done anything to this welder as far as upgrades. The only thing I've done is I put on a better ground clamp. And this is just a much better design than the cheap little alligator type clips that come with it. This just grabs onto things in a much better way. Grabs onto bigger pieces of pipe and more unusual shapes. But it's just as simple as undoing a bolt, taking the old one off, and then bolting this on. So that's really all I've done. You know, you really need to have a cart for these, you know, so you can move it around, because the bottle is kind of cumbersome and, you know, you don't want to knock it over and damage your regulators. But the only other tool that really goes with this and that is really essential to have with this is you need a set of what are called MIG pliers. And, you know, there are some American companies, and I should have bought some when I first got started. But when I first got started with this, you know, I just bought the welder and stuff, and I saw these at Harbor Freight. They were on sale for $3.99, Pittsburgh brand, and I have no regrets. They've worked fantastic for me. So $3.99 versus $35 or $40. I mean, I love American products and have many, many American products, but I just, when I was first getting started, I couldn't see spending that kind of money on something that I really wasn't even sure how it worked. But each one of these weird things that this has are tools that work specifically with the MIG welder. And you'll see that in the process while I'm working with it. And so, for me, the most important aspect of welding, you know, getting ready to weld, is to be able to accurately cut your material and cut it to size, cut it to a manageable size, even do joinery, cut miters, cut, you know, lap shoulders and angle iron and all kinds of stuff. And this is the tool right here. I do not have an abrasive chop saw. I had one. I could not stand it. They're just a mess. They're loud, sparks everywhere. So I gave it to a friend. And one of the guys that wants to start welding, but wants to buy the, you know, the huge welder. But see, he still has no welder, and he's still not welding because he's holding out. But this Portaband, this thing is the greatest invention ever. I have two of them. See, I have this one back here that I keep set up in this stand. So I use this as a portable upright bandsaw for cutting smaller things, cutting bolts off and what have you. And then this is what I use to cut all my, I use this freehand. But if you can scribe a line or make a mark on steel, this thing has such precision capabilities. Once you get the hang of manipulating it, you can make precision cuts with this thing. And the blades are cheap, they're bimetal, they last a long, long time. They really last a long time once you really learn how to handle and manipulate this, because you won't torque the machine and put undue stress on these. They're pretty brittle blades because they are so hard. They're like 8% cobalt, and so the blade is pretty brittle, but it will, if you can pretty much fit something into the throat of this, it will cut it, no matter what kind of metal it is. It'll make a pretty good dent in it for sure. And I mean, it'll just go through mild steel like it's nothing. So some of the other tools that you really need to have is you need to have a drill press. A drill press is just one of the most fundamental steel fabrication tools out there. And actually, a couple of the projects for this welding series involve my drill press, and I'll cover those a little bit later. Now, I try to do almost all of my grinding to create the bevels that you need for welding. I try to do almost all of those on my big, powerful pedestal grinder. And so I really use that thing a lot. You'll see me use it a lot in the series. But there are many times when that is not appropriate and you have to use an angle grinder. And I have this little Makita 4.25 inch angle grinder. I've had this thing for, I think, about 16 years, and I can't seem to kill it. And I've run it hard. But this is as big an angle grinder as I ever want to own. These things scare me. They can be really dangerous. There's no stopping this thing once it gets going. I mean, they can be really dangerous. People have been killed using angle grinders, so I don't want to use anything bigger and more powerful than this. They can be real unpredictable, especially with things like knotted wire wheels, where they can get real grabby. I've hurt my wrists and elbows just, you know, having kind of bucking backlash from this thing. So this is as big an angle grinder as I want. But the variety of tools that they run is pretty unbelievable. You know, these are those cleaning and descaling tools that 3M makes. These pads that fit on this thing that just threads onto the arbor. They're these lapped abrasive pads. These are probably my least favorite because I think they're kind of overpriced and they get misshapen and glazed over. These are what I like a lot, these 24 grit pads that go on this backer here. They're real easy to change and they're not expensive. I will run the hard discs too, but these are my least favorite just because I don't like the sparks and the byproduct of these things shedding. They're just pretty toxic and gross. But the other tool that is really handy is just to have a little die grinder. This is just a little $99 Makita, and again, this is as big a die grinder as I want to own. You know, the angle grinder and this are definitely two-hand tools. If you're running this, you have two hands on this at all time. Here you've got an exposed cutting barrel of solid carbide that will basically float and feather and bevel steel like, you know, like it's nothing. And it's an exposed, and it's spinning at 25,000 RPMs, you know. Two hands on this thing at all times. And I use my jigsaw a lot with bimetal blades in it, so I'm always using my jigsaw to clean corners out and, if I have a bounded surface, because I don't own a plasma cutter, and I'd like to have one, but I'm not willing to pay for one at this time. I just don't really do that much plate work and stuff. But I will also use this old Sawzall, this Porter Cable style Sawzall with a bimetal blade on it. And this is a fantastic tool for, especially if you have to reach into something to make a cut where you don't really have good access to get the porta band in, or, you know, if you don't want to. The last time I used this, I was cutting a bunch of galvanized metal grating apart, and so I didn't want to use the cutting torch because I didn't want the galvanized fumes going everywhere. I didn't want to deal with that, so I used some of these Lennox gold line Sawzall blades, these bimetals, and they just gobbled up that quarter inch steel that was making this grating, and I had that stuff cut apart like before you know it. But even with a torch, it would have been tough because the grating was like this, and the verticals where I was trying to cut apart, it would have been hard to get the torch down in there. So this is a handy tool. This is what I use probably the least, but when I need it, I really need it. And so one of the things, I have a oxyacetylene rig here, and I don't use it that much. I mean, to be honest with you, I haven't filled this bottle of acetylene up in years, and it just seems to keep going. I've changed the oxygen out a couple times, but I don't use it that much, and so it, for me, it's a it's a really handy thing for cutting plate and you know, making cuts that would just kind of take forever with this. And I do use this in the series, and you'll see me do it, but I'm not that skilled with it. I have some issues with the propane or with the cutting torch, but I can make it work, and you'll see me make some cuts with it. It's a good thing to have, and everybody needs to have a basic understanding of how to use it. And probably the most important thing that any steel fabricator can have is a good selection of clamps. And these clamps, these Vessi rapid action clamps, these are life changers. When you start using these things, they make C-clamps and stuff seem like grandma's world. You know, you feel like you're going back to the horse and buggy times after you've used these for a while. And I use my pipe clamps all the time too. You know, there's nothing plastic on them. This is ductile cast iron. You know, nothing sticks to it. I mean, I can weld right up next to it without a problem. These kind of vice grips, these are really handy, and you know, they provide a real nice point load and step over stuff. So they're very handy too. But these are what I use the most. These Vessi rapid action clamps. So clamps are just incredible. And you will need a welding shield. This is what's called an auto darkening welding shield. This is nothing fancy. This was like $85. This is a Miller Pro Hobby, and it's really light and comfortable. And on the inside, I have a one diopter cheater lens in here to help me see a little bit better. And this protective piece of polycarbonate on the outside. This is a disposable thing that you just pop this cover off and you just put a new one in every, depending on how much you're welding, because the BBs and the fumes will cloud and damage this, and this protects the sensor and the permanent part of the hood. And so this is just a consumable that you just change out. But this is a real nice, comfortable, you know, simple auto darkening helmet, you know. So I like it a lot. I have no complaints about it at all. Well, the weak point of this series is definitely going to be the close-ups of the actual welding. I made this special box for my camera to go in, and then this would sit on the tripod. And I was, you know, hoping to get really good close-ups of producing the three main weld patterns that I use: the circular motion, the U shape, or I call it a horseshoe a lot of times, or then just the straight push. But I made this just to protect my really nice little HD camera from weld spatter and stuff, and I made it to where I could put a dark shield in it too, and other than just this clear polycarbonate. But what I found is the closer I got to the welding arc, the electromagnetic interference of the welder created static and interference on the camera. Now, you'll see in the series, I will include footage, but you'll see that it's just not that good. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to have some links to some better close-up footage that other people have that were able to produce. And probably the way they were able to produce it is with a really high quality camera with a really good telephoto or zoom lens, where they could be at distance and basically just reach out and see that close-up from distance, and my camera won't do that. But I think the strong point of this series is to show how simple and flexible this welding process is to get a grasp of, that it is not complicated, and it does not require an incredible investment in tools and equipment to get started. And you're going to be so shocked at the array of things that you can make for your shop out of basically just a hodgepodge of leftover steel and scrap and things like that. You're going to also, you'll never drive past a piece of steel laying on the side of the road again if you can just snag it, because every piece of steel now could potentially be something for you to work into a project. And the other thing is that you're going to also see one of the projects in this series is going to be where I've modified something that I had already made. And this is going to show you how easy it is to take something that you've already fabricated in steel and make a correction or a modification as your needs change. And that it is just really not that big a deal, and steel really lends, steel and the welding process really lend itself to reworking things over and over again until you get them just the way you want them or as your needs change. So let's look at the projects that we're going to work on, and then we'll go through the whole setup and then just get going.